And as he went out of the temple, notice Jesus went out of the temple, one of his disciples saith unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here. And Jesus answering said unto him, Seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And this is yet future when Christ returns to Jerusalem at the seventh trumpet. There shall not be left one stone upon another because Jerusalem will be cleansed at that time. And there's a deeper spiritual meaning within that as well if you know how to enumerate the stones worn smooth as we're told to do in the last verse of Revelation 13. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives over against the temple, which is the exact location of where Christ will return to earth, as we know from Zechariah chapter 14, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled? So the questions here are, what and when? The where being self-evident, Jerusalem, obviously. Verse 5, And Jesus answering them began to say, and now Christ begins to teach the seven seals in the order he opens them in the book of Revelation. Take heed, lest any man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. So within this first seal, you have an all-purpose warning against deception, whether it be someone claiming to be a Christian teaching false doctrine. Those stones we spoke of earlier with their hidden dynasty of religion keeps that false doctrine alive in the world, twisting scripture just like their father the devil did in Matthew chapter 4 to deceive people into worshiping instead of Christ. That's what Antichrist means, is instead of Christ. The sixth seal, the sixth trumpet, and the sixth vial is when he shall appear in Jerusalem, and his one world religious system will at that time come into being. But this final generation began in 1948, and that set the stage for Satan's appearance as Antichrist in Jerusalem, the rider of the white horse in the first seal that you can read of in Revelation chapter 6. We know from Revelation chapter 19 that the true Christ returns at the seventh trumpet riding a white horse, but the rider of the white horse in the first seal is the false Christ. Notice he has a bow, and that's toxon in the Greek, as the simplest fabric, a cheap fabric imitation, the religious beast written of in Revelation chapter 13, because when he appears, that's when his one world religious system comes into being. So now we move on to the second seal in Mark chapter 13 and verse 7, and when ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be ye not troubled, for such things must needs be, but the end shall not be yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. Just prior to Satan's appearance as Antichrist, the one world political system comes into being at the woe of the fifth trumpet, and then that one world political system, the New World Order as it's called, is wounded to death, and then the woe of the sixth trumpet occurs, and that's when Satan will make war with the saints. Spiritual war, that is to say, because as we know from Daniel 8, Satan will with peace destroy many, claiming to be the Prince of Peace, when he's really the destroyer, as we know from Revelation chapter 9 and verse 11, and it's at the sixth trumpet, the woe of the sixth trumpet, that the first six seals, trumpets and vials, go into their ultimate spiritual fulfillment. Spiritual death, spiritual famine, spiritual war, and again, the rider of the white horse in the first seal is Satan in his role of Antichrist ultimately, but it's also symbolic of the hidden dynasty of religion. Until the five-month-long hour of temptation, which begins with the woe of the fifth trumpet, we're still going to hear of wars and rumors of wars, and there'll be deception concerning the return of Christ. The any-moment rapture deception especially, which came about in 1830, and there's also evidence that this was the same year, 1830, that the counterfeit so-called Pentecostal tongue came about. That's also the year that Joseph Smith's so-called Additional Testament was published, so 1830 was a big year for false doctrine that we still have with us to this day. Christ is about to mention famines and troubles, and as we know from Amos chapter 8, there will be a famine for hearing God's word taught properly, and that's with us today, obviously, but it will reach the extreme during the five-month-long hour of temptation, and especially in the middle of that five-month-long hour of temptation when Satan appears as the false Christ. But the deception plagues the world already, in case you haven't noticed, because of the four hidden dynasties of religion, politics, economics, economics, and education. And I list them in that order because that's how they line up with these first four seals in the build-up to the hour of temptation. They're not in chronological order as far as the seals are concerned, but they go 4, 3, 2, 1 as far as the first four seals are concerned, but with the trumpets and vials, they go 1, 2, 3, 4. So the first seal we read of, which lines up with the hidden dynasty of religion, 1948 being the beginning of the generation of the fig tree when the Kenites returned to Jerusalem. This was also the year that the United Nations World Council of Churches was formed. There you have the skeletal structure of Satan's one world religious system, basically, with the World Council of Churches. So 1948, as far as the first seal is concerned, and the second seal, which is the hidden dynasty of politics and the United Nations, was formed after the two world wars and will provide the skeletal structure for the one world political system, and that was established in 1945 after the Second World War. Just before World War I, the third seal, economics, in 1913, when the Kenites formed the Federal Reserve System, with the petrodollar later becoming the world currency, and that's the embryonic stage of the one world economic system that will be established during that 5-month long hour of temptation. That's that rider of the black horse with those scales. Those are the balances of deceit that you can also read of in Amos chapter 8. The balances of deceit, fixing the scales with the Federal Reserve System, and it's on the Federal Reserve $1 note that Satan is depicted as the cornerstone, the false cornerstone, the false rock, the king of Tyrus, as he's called in Ezekiel chapter 28. Tyrus means rock, and those smooth stones that we spoke of earlier are his children, the Kenites, who carry out the negative part of God's plan with the four hidden dynasties. So the fourth seal, which is death, that's one of Satan's names, and hell followed with him, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beasts of the earth. That's Therion in the Greek, a venomous beast. The political and the religious ultimately, but there is a build-up with the four hidden dynasties and the first four trumpet seals and vials. So the fourth seal would then line up with education, and again, power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth, that's all of the earth, the number of earth is four, to kill, spiritually speaking, with sword, that's the hidden dynasty of politics, and with hunger, that's famine, the hidden dynasty of economics, and with death, that's the fourth seal itself, and with the beasts of the earth, not only the political, but also the religious, which we saw in the first seal. The rider of the white horse in the first seal is the false Christ. That's the religious beast written of in Revelation chapter 13. So in 1830, that first vial, that first plague written of in Revelation chapter 16 was poured out upon the earth, with Margaret MacDonald being patient zero of the first plague written of in Revelation 16. That spiritual plague of the mind of deception would then spread throughout the world, and so it is this day with the any moment flyaway doctrine. The year 1830 was also the year that the Rothschilds invented Zionism, Nazism, Fascism, and Communism, according to the author of Secrets of the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve being set up in 1913, and just prior to that, in the late 1800s, the news agencies were monopolized so the information can be controlled, the educational system itself being set up in those years as well to carry out the initial programming, but the global media system is what keeps the deception flowing on a continuous basis. So that pretty well covers the hidden dynasty of education. The fourth seal, the first trumpet, and the first vial. That's 411, which means information, another word for education. So to continue with Mark chapter 13 and verse 8, and there shall be earthquakes in diverse places, and so it is, and there shall be famines and troubles, that's the third and fourth seal. These are the beginning of sorrows, which means the birth pangs, the build-up to that 5-month long hour of temptation. And troubles means a disturbance of the water. When you look up this word in the Strong's Concordance or on the blueletterbible.org website, you'll see the outline of biblical usage to agitate, trouble, a thing by the movement of its parts to and fro, to cause one inward commotion, take away his calmness of mind, to disquiet, make restless, to stir up, to trouble, to strike one's spirit with fear and dread, to render anxious or distressed, to perplex the mind of one by suggesting scruples or doubts, to stir or agitate royal water. And what are the waters symbolic of? That we know from Revelation chapter 17, verse 15. The waters are symbolic of peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. What happens when you disturb water? It gets cloudy, just as the minds of the people of the world are clouded by the Kenites through their four hidden dynasties, the media being the apparatus used to transmit the deception, and this includes the news agencies, so-called, the movies, the television, the internet for the most part, books, to the point where most people are now mindless zombies. So having covered the build-up with the first four seals, trumpets and vials, we move on to the fifth seal, which has to do with God's elect being delivered up to death, which is one of Satan's names, which is when the Holy Spirit will speak through them in the true Pentecostal tongue, which means whoever hears it will hear it in their own language. You don't need an interpreter, and this, of course, doesn't happen until Satan appears, but the fifth trumpet has to do with the sealing of the servants of God in their forehead, and the benchmark that began the 555 time frame that we are now in happened in 1969. That eagle flying through the midst of heaven that you can read of in the last verse of Revelation chapter 8, it says eagle there, not angel. That's a mistranslation. The eagle being the clue as to what that benchmark was. It was an unprecedented event, and it had to do with the Cold War between Jacob and Esau. The wars and rumors of wars that we hear of now primarily have to do with the struggle between the two twins, Jacob and Esau, the two superpowers, the United States and Russia. Those are the two leaders of the two sides that are in the world today. Five is grace in biblical numerics, so it is a grace period up until the woe of the fifth trumpet occurs and that one world political system emerges when Satan and his angels are cast from heaven unto the earth. That's when the lion and the bear, the Christian nations led by the United States, and the bear, which is the non-Christian nations led by Russia, rise up together along with the leopard, which is symbolic of the Kenites and their four hidden dynasties. That's the infrastructure of the one world political system, as well as Daniel's fourth beast, which is the supernatural. All four of these rise up together at the same time at the woe of the fifth trumpet. That's the one world political system, the New World Order. But that New World Order is wounded to death, as we know from Revelation chapter 13. And after that is when Satan appears at the woe of the sixth trumpet, which is when God's elect are delivered up. So with that having been said, Mark 13 and verse 9. But take heed to yourselves, for they shall deliver you up to councils, and in the synagogues ye shall be beaten, and ye shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake, for the sake of the true Christ, for a testimony against them. And the gospel must first be published among all nations, and so it shall be at that time transmitted throughout the earth what the Holy Spirit shall say through God's elect, which is one reason you see four listed here. Councils, synagogues, which is the synagogue of Satan, you can read of in Revelation chapters 2 and 3, rulers and kings. That word rulers is number 2232 in your Greek dictionary of your Strong's Concordance, a chief person, in this case Antichrist. Those 10 kings written of in Daniel 7 are part of Daniel's fourth beast, meaning they're exclusively supernatural. They're 10 fallen angel kings that are cast out of heaven with Satan at the woe of the fifth trumpet. The delivering up of the elect not occurring until after Satan appears as Antichrist, and you had a perfect example of that with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel chapter 3. Notice also that it's four of the disciples Christ is speaking to here, Peter and James and John and Andrew, four being the number of earth, and these same four disciples would later in Acts chapter 2, along with the other apostles, would be spoken through by the Holy Spirit, and it was heard by everyone in their own language. Verse 11, but when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what you shall speak, neither do ye premeditate. Meditate. But whatsoever shall be given you in that hour, in the latter half of the hour of temptation, that speak ye, for it is not ye that speak, but the Holy Spirit. Now the brother shall betray the brother to death, and the father the son, and the children shall rise up against their parents, and shall cause them to be put to death. Death being one of Satan's names. Those who are biblically illiterate will think that they're saving their family members by causing them to be delivered up to the devil, because they don't know that it's the devil. they think that it's Jesus. That's when the Holy Spirit shall speak through them, and it will be broadcast throughout the world, and many will come out of the confusion and into the truth, repenting, realizing the reality of the situation. This includes that 144,000 that are redeemed from the earth, as we know from Revelation chapter 14. That's why they have to have that seal of God placed in their forehead before the 5 months can begin. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, for the sake of the true Christ, you're remaining faithful to the true Christ because you understand that Satan is the false Christ and that he appears in Jerusalem before the true Christ returns. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved, resurrecting into eternal life at the first resurrection that you can read of in Revelation chapter 20. Verse 14, and now we come to the appearance of the desolator in the sixth seal, the sixth trumpet, and the sixth vial. But when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation, the desolator spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing where he ought not, to better translate this verse, it's not a condition, it's an entity, is Satan appearing in his role of Antichrist. Let him that readeth understand. Then let them that be in Judea flee to the mountains. Why? Because after Satan appears as the false Christ, the true Christ will return, and that's when not one stone shall be left standing upon another. He's going to turn Jerusalem into sand. That's the subject of Mark chapter 13, is the return of the true Christ. These are the things that happen beforehand. Satan appearing as Antichrist in the midst of the week, Daniel's 70th week, but those days have been shortened to a 5-month period. That means the woe of the fifth trumpet happens at the beginning of the 5-month long hour of temptation, then the deadly wound, and then in the middle, the woe of the sixth trumpet, which is when Satan appears as the false Christ, and that's when they receive that mark of the beast in their forehead, which is the deception. Verse 15, and let him that is on the housetop, this is a watchman, not go down into the house, neither enter therein to take anything out of his house. And let him that is in the field is the world, as we know from Matthew 13, not turn back again for to take up his garment. The end is about to happen. Is why? Because the true Christ is about to return. There's only 2.5 months between the appearance of Satan as the false Christ and the return of the true Christ at the seventh trumpet. The seventh seal tells us of silence in heaven about the space of half an hour, the hour of temptation being a 5-month period, and what's half of 5 months? It's 2.5 months, but that's my own math. Do your own math and come to your own conclusion. Study to show yourself approved, and don't listen to man. Listen to God. Verse 17, but woe to them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days. Woe to those that are impregnated in their mind with the mark of the beast, which is the deception. The end thereof. Right hand part is a figure of speech, meaning the work that they do, nursing along Satan's work, giving suck. These are the so-called wonderful works that they'll be bragging about whenever the true Christ returns, as you can read of in Matthew chapter 7. But what will the true Christ say to those people? Depart from me, ye that work iniquity, and pray ye that your flight be not in the winter. The point is getting away from Jerusalem because it's about to be destroyed. For in those days shall be affliction. This is the great tribulation. The tribulation of Almighty God, such as was not from the beginning of the creation, which God created unto this time, neither shall be. The great tribulation, the tribulation of Almighty God, begins whenever the true Christ returns. There are two tribulations, Satan's tribulation, which is 5 months, followed immediately by the tribulation of Almighty God, which, believe it or not, is for 1,000 years. That's why it says in Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 14, the great day of the Lord is near, and a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is 1 day. It is near and hasteth greatly, even the voice of the day of the Lord. The mighty man shall cry there bitterly. Verse 15, that day is a day of wrath. How long is the day of the Lord? It's 1,000 years. A day of trouble and distress, a day of wasteness and desolation, a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness. For those who didn't take part in the first resurrection, they're cast into the outer darkness, as Christ said in the Gospels. A day of the trumpet, it begins with the seventh trumpet when the true Christ returns, an alarm against the fenced cities and against the high towers. Verse 17, and I will bring distress upon men, and they shall walk like blind men, cast into the outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth, because they have sinned against the Lord, and their blood shall be poured out as dust, and their flesh as the dung, all being changed into spiritual bodies at that time. Those who aren't worshiping Antichrist whenever the true Christ returns will take part in the first resurrection. The others will have to wait until the 1,000 years are finished to stand against Satan after he's let loose from the bottomless pit for a short season. And if they stand against him, then they take part in the second resurrection and go into the eternity, which is the third world age. If they follow Satan at that time, then they'll be blotted out in the lake of fire, which is the second death. This is why it says in Revelation chapter 7 that these are they which came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. They took part in the second resurrection because they were taught by the 144,000 that you can find written of earlier in Revelation chapter 7. They were redeemed from the earth, and as we know from Ezekiel chapter 44, they teach the people during the 1,000 years. Therefore are they before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple, and he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. And this doesn't happen until the 1,000 years are finished. The great white throne judgment happens at that time when the full Godhead returns to earth. Then the third world age begins, the eternity. There are three world ages, and if you don't understand that, then you're never going to understand the word of God. Verse 16 of Revelation chapter 7, they shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. Verse 17, for the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And as you know from the end of the book of Revelation, in chapter 21, that's the third world age, which is the eternity, when God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. The memory of those loved ones who had to be blotted out in the lake of fire will be erased, because they'll be erased from existence. It'll be as though they never existed, as far as you are concerned. So that's what happens at the end of the Great Tribulation, which is the tribulation of Almighty God. Verse 20 of Mark chapter 13, now we rewind back to that 5-month-long hour of temptation, and except that the Lord had shortened those days, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, whom he hath chosen, he hath shortened the days. And then, if any man shall say to you, lo, here is Christ, or lo, he is there, believe him not, for false Christs and false prophets shall rise, and shall show signs and wonders to seduce, if it were possible, even the elect. But take ye heed, behold, I have foretold you all things. So what days were shortened? The entire 7 years of Daniel's 70th week. 7 days, which are really years, have been shortened to a 5-month period, as we know from Revelation chapter 9. That entire 5-month period is the hour of temptation, so you want to be on the lookout for a decoy antichrist, even, possibly, during the first half hour. There's more written about that first half hour of the hour of temptation in Daniel chapter 11, verses 21 through 30, than probably anywhere else in the Word of God. That covers the first 2.5 months. Then in Daniel chapter 11, verse 31, you see the abomination that maketh desolate, the desolator. That marks the midst of the week. Those days having been shortened, that now marks the midst of the 5-month-long hour of temptation. Verse 24, and now we come to the return of the true Christ at the 7th trumpet, the 7th vial, and immediately after that half hour written of in the 7th seal. So 777 is when the true Christ returns, which is immediately after 666. The 6th seal, the 6th trumpet, and the 6th vial last for 2.5 months. So immediately after that, in those days after that tribulation, after Satan's tribulation, comes the tribulation of Almighty God. The sun shall be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars of heaven shall fall, and the powers that are in heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory, this being a cloud of people with those Christ brings with him upon his return. The armies of heaven you can read of in Revelation chapter 19. And then shall he send his angels, and shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from the uttermost part of the earth to the uttermost part of heaven, meaning those who had died and gone to be with the Father beforehand throughout the centuries, return with Christ to earth to reign for the 1,000 years with him, to teach the people. Those who are alive and remain will be changed into spiritual bodies, taking part in the first resurrection and being gathered to Jerusalem. That's the return of the good figs written of in Jeremiah chapter 24, verse 28. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When her branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, Ye know that summer is near, and summer is the harvest time, which is the end of the world, as we also know from Matthew chapter 13. Notice it says leaves there and not fruit. Only a Christian nation can bring forth fruit for the kingdom of God. Whenever Cain was conceived in Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve covered themselves with fig leaves, and that's the first time the word sorrow is mentioned in God's word. Remember back in verse 8 where he said these are the beginning of sorrows? That means birth pangs. Cain was born first, then Abel. They were twins from two different fathers. Abel was Adam's son, and Cain was the seed of the serpent, who is the devil. So then who returned to Jerusalem first in 1948? The sons of Cain, the Kenites. When will the good figs return? Christ just told us in Mark 13, and then shall they see the Son of Man, the true Christ, at the seventh trumpet, coming in the clouds with great power and glory, and then shall he send his angels, and shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from the uttermost part of the earth to the uttermost part of heaven. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. So Cain was born first, the sons of Cain returned to Jerusalem first, those evil figs who are the children of Satan, who will appear as Antichrist before the true Christ returns. 6 comes before 7, and as you can see, it's throughout the Word of God, that same pattern over and over again. So now learn a parable of the fig tree, when her branch is yet tender, and putteth forth leaves, not fruit, but leaves, ye know that summer is near. So ye in like manner, when ye shall see these things come to pass, know that it is nigh, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, that this generation, the generation of the fig tree, which began in 1948, shall not pass till all these things be done. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. But of that day, the day of the Lord, the 1,000 years, and that hour, the hour of temptation, just prior to that, knoweth no man, no, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, but the Father. Take ye heed, watch and pray, for ye know not when the time is. For the Son of Man, Christ that is to say, is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants and to every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch. Watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at even, or at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning. This doesn't mean Christ will return at any moment. It means you don't know when the woe of the fifth trumpet, which kicks off the 5-month-long hour of temptation, will occur. So don't go to sleep spiritually, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping, spiritually speaking, and what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch.